And the first item on the agenda.
First item is 2016-069, an update and a resolve seeking update on the status of the city's corrected FEMA maps. And Mr. Joe Shea is here to speak.
Thank you very much, Madam Clerk. Good evening, Mr. Shea. How are you?
Very well, Madam President. Thank you for having me this evening.
Thank you for coming to update us yet again on these never-ending battles with the FEMA folks. So thank you very much.
You're very welcome. For the at-home viewer, I'm Joseph Daniel Shea. I'm a senior principal with Woodard and Curran, an engineering firm that has been working with the city of Quincy on their flood maps for far too long. And tonight we're going to give you an update on what we hope is the final stretch for the city's letter of map revision appeal of the June 9th, 2014 flood maps, or in the council parlance, order 2016-69. This issue certainly has been a long, winding road. It began in the winter of 2013 or 2014 when FEMA quietly reissued some new flood maps, an activity that had been very routine for about a decade, where maps would come out with a 1 or 2% change. However, with this new version that came out in winter of 2013-2014, along the coast, FEMA had changed a lot of their approaches, their science, their modeling, and some communities were seeing a 25 to 30% changes in the impacts of the maps. That change gained quite a bit of regional and national momentum in the summer of 2014. And as I will go in to remind everybody, the city took some action in June of 2014 that was scheduled on paper to take 8 or 9 months. However, we're entering almost 3 years of activity with FEMA to try to get these maps correct. We've received, as of 2 weeks ago, some information from FEMA that makes us believe that this process will be concluded in April of 2017. Originally, in the winter of 2013 and 14, the city had laid out a multi-path approach to addressing these maps. The first approach was to do a citywide appeal. That will be the focus of our topic tonight and has been the focus of our three-year effort. The city also laid out a program to assist residents in dealing with their individual parcels. And the city outlined a program to try to make sure that they were appropriately handling all of their flood protection activities, such to garner points in a program that FEMA discounts all of the flood protection policies in Quincy by 10% because of the city's proactive nature and coordination on flood control activities. Tonight, again, we're going to focus solely on the first leg of this stool in terms of the city's approach. When we had worked to come up with some new science, some new data to basically attack maps that were clearly inaccurate when they were issued on June 9th, 2014, we did some math, and we determined that there were about 2,700 parcels in Quincy that had an increased flood designation and increased insurance costs. There were 1,400 newly mapped parcels. So these are people who had never been in the floodplain, were never told they were coming into the floodplain, and when these new maps were issued by FEMA magically, they were now in the floodplain because of FEMA's new methodology. And there were about 500 parcels with no change in designation, yet everybody was looking at increases in their flood insurance costs. All of the changes of these new maps were along the coast. FEMA made no changes along Quincy's brooks. So those people who were further up on Furnace Brook or Town Brook or Sachem Creek did not have insurance, did not have flood zone changes, but they were still subject to insurance rate changes. Then began what was a number of meetings. I stood before this council almost a dozen times. We had about a dozen neighborhood meetings. This slide is not intended for me to go down each and every date, but for some key milestones, on January 13th, 2015, FEMA approved the city's letter of map revision appeals, science and data, They approved it as compliant. They approved it as appropriate. Yet today, almost 2 years later, we're still battling to get usable maps. So shame on me for assuming that an approval meant that we would then be moving into a phase where we could have usable documents. We've continued to try to fight that battle. Another very important milestone on this chart is July 22nd, 2015. FEMA had opened a public comment period, and there were a total of 44 comments submitted by people in the city of Quincy, which was a wonderful success rate for public comment period at the federal level. I know several councilors had submitted letters. I'm going to guess some people here in the council chamber tonight had submitted some letters, and we once again want to thank people for submitting letters, because that really drew the attention to Quincy by FEMA's review team. Normally, they get no comments whatsoever. The dates continue on this long and winding road. Unfortunately, although FEMA received a number of comments in July, on March 28th, 2016, FEMA had replied to each and every of the 44 letters, and they indicated that the input from the letter did not comply with their appeal guidelines, therefore the input would not be included in the maps, which was incredibly disappointed from our federal level government. However, by that point, we did have their attention, and we were meeting once a month to review technical data. Finally, on April 4th, I came and gave you an update that the letter of map revisions would start to be issued, but that we were given no deadline on when we would get the corrected maps. Now that the dust is about to settle, there were five different dates when FEMA issued corrected maps. This part is very important because it becomes very confusing. The city appealed one single map. However, the city was given back five different snapshots of corrected maps. We were never given a single holistic map that includes all of the changes, all of the science, all of the data that the city had determined. So the city has been left with effectively something that looks like a quilt when you go down to DPW if you were to stitch them all together. The other very important component about receiving five different corrected maps is, depending upon where you live in the city, your revision may be on one map, but not on another. Your revision may be on the second map, and then it was updated on the fourth map. So it's very important that the people at home realize it's looking at the proper map and most current map for your parcel is critical. And I do expect to receive quite a bit of commentary on this. We've been over this with the staff at DPW, and I'm sure we'll talk about it a little more. But I can't stress enough, knowing what map your parcel is on and what the effective date of that map is a very important piece of information. We do know from FEMA that the final map has been issued on December 1st. It will be effective April 14th. So we have worked to incorporate one electronic version that is all five changes. This is a little picture of the quilt, but every time you see a different color, it's one of those different effective dates, showing how the FEMA basically released portions of the city, but they also overlapped each other. So there's portions of Howe's Neck, for example, that were in both the green effective map and then superseded by the blue effective map, for example. As confusing as this map looks, this is the map you'll get if you go to the FEMA website, where you would have to go through and click on each of these purple bars to try to find out, is that your house, is that your neighborhood? There are so many changes that the FEMA website really is unworkable. This is one of the reasons why we're recommending that the city really lobby to get single, holistic, corrected maps and not a quilt. To try to mitigate for anybody who has to try to go to the FEMA website and click on all of these different locations, we have continued to work with the city's DPW on the city's online property viewer. Now, for those of you who don't know, on the city's webpage on the right-hand side, typically maybe a screen or two down from when you originally log on. There's a white rectangle on the right-hand side. It says GIS Property Viewer. And within that property viewer, you can find your own property and you can look up a number of different pieces of information about the city's infrastructure or wetlands or flood zones around your property. So if you click on this white box, you can then at the top where there is a small magnifying glass, you can enter in your address and you can search your address. And then for the purposes of this presentation, if you go down the right-hand side, you can actually activate different themes. And in this map, I've activated the 2015 Quincy proposed flood zone theme. So what you can see on that map, the blue is a flood zone. And once you've activated a theme, you can zoom in to a high degree of clarity. Like you see on the right-hand side here, to really pick off your individual house. This is a house I happen to select on John Street for the purposes of discussion. But it allows clarity to see the house outlined in yellow. You can clearly see that the floodplain touches the front part of its property, but it does not touch the house. That means this house is not in need of flood insurance. It is the house that you are insuring, not the property. So there is absolutely room for confusion when you have the flood zone on your property. But if it doesn't touch your house, you do not need flood insurance. You may choose to get flood insurance. Your mortgage company may try to get you to have flood insurance. But according to FEMA regulations, you do not need it. One of the reasons why we show this map on the right-hand side for the Quincy viewer is because the map on the left-hand side is the best available view you're going to get from FEMA. And the little tiny rectangle is the same house on John Street, where FEMA's maps are just produced at a level of clarity that doesn't allow you to know where some houses are in, some houses are out. The tool that's been created for the city's webpage is a significantly useful tool. The city should be very proud of it, and it is an excellent resource for mortgage companies, insurers, real estate agents, and most importantly, homeowners. Because the difference between being in and out can be the difference between several hundred or several thousand dollars in flood insurance each year. You can make a much more educated decision as to whether you want or need flood insurance on your property based upon the data that the city's been able to produce. So here are what we are forecasting is the final results of all of the map corrections. This incorporates the map that will be effective on April 14th, 2017. And this is based upon parcels, but we believe there's 2,530 parcels with decreased flood designation, meaning improved flood status. 553 parcels removed from the floodplain by the city's LOMER efforts. And there's another 120 parcels or structures that were removed from the floodplain by letter of map amendments, that individual parcel approach, that second path in the city's strategy. So we're looking at over 3,000 parcels with an improved status because of Quincy's effort. I want to be clear that at this point, we've had the information for about a week. These are parcels. We're working to get addresses. Some of these parcels don't have homes on them. Some parcels have condominiums and actually might have 8 or 10 or 12 addresses on them. We want to make sure we take our time to get all of the addresses proper with who has received the benefit of this work, who is out of the floodplain, who has an improved flood risk. So we need a little more time to prepare that information. So where we are today is that the city is updating its online GIS viewer for the 2017 maps. We expect that to be done early next week. There'll be a layer called 2017 Corrected FEMA Flood Zones on that right-hand side. FEMA has issued a final public comment period. It was advertised in the Patriot Ledger last Thursday. They're asking people to provide comments by April 14th. That is the presumptive effective date of the maps, because normally they receive no comments. And we are recommending that anybody provide comments by April 1st, because we do expect people in Quincy to be engaged in this process and provide comments. One nuance from the last time. FEMA had 44 comments sent directly to them during the last public comment period. They're asking that all comments be sent to the mayor's office, compiled, and then a single package be sent to FEMA this time around. That we think that will give us more leverage in dealing with FEMA to try to get the maps finalized, so I'm supportive of that. And the city engineer's office has reestablished counter hours and phone support for anybody who needs help understanding the impact to their parcel. The address and phone number and the hours are up on the screen. I'm happy to say Chen Sang from the city engineer's office is here with me today. Chen's been supportive of this effort and has done a wonderful job at trying to deal with all the miscellaneous issues that FEMA sends through the city engineer's office. If you go to the city engineer's office, they have all five letters of map determination, the quilt. So if you want to look at the actual FEMA maps, you can get them there. They've got the online viewer set up on the counter, so they can pull up your property right there, and you can work with one of the engineers. They have guidance on unique situations, such as you have the floodplain on your property, but it doesn't touch your structure, using the previous example. And they have thousands of elevation certificates on file that may be of assistance to people concerning your individual property. So the ongoing steps for the city is to continue to lobby FEMA to create a single, holistic, corrected map for its constituents and your constituents. There's a massive amount of confusion out there because of the tools that FEMA has sent to the city that are not as useful as we would like them to be. We'll continue to assist residents with questions at DPW and via phone. The city will compile any remaining comments by April 14th and send in a package. And then unfortunately, here's the punchline, but we are proactively working with FEMA to provide data because they've indicated that their next round of maps will be out in the 2018-2019 timeframe. So we're vowing not to go through this again, but the program is starting to lap itself and gear up to be done again. The next round is going to focus on inland rivers and streams. Hopefully their changes to the coast are done. And now they will go to the portions of the flood zone that they hadn't previously worked on. So with that, I'd like to entertain any questions that the council may have. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Shea. Thank you. Yes, Councilor LaForest.
Thank you, Madam President. I've long been awaiting for this update, Mr. Shea, and I'm very appreciative of your presence this evening. I feel you and I have been talking pretty frequently in the past few months, awaiting. We're getting more information. It's still pending. We're getting more information. It's still pending. You know, it's really frustrating for my constituents who have that, you know, they've got a deadline. They have to renew their flood policy, right? And so that's the deadline that they're looking for. And what do I do and where do I stand? And us trying to get that information. It's really frustrating for FEMA to give us hard deadlines, and yet every deadline they have is fluid, and they just keep changing the dates. You and I started talking earlier this evening. It's like Groundhog's Day. This is year three. We're going into year four. We started this process in 2013. Is that correct? 2013. We're going into 2017. And you closed your presentation with FEMA is going to do this again to us in 2018. I mean, it's so frustrating when you pull up, for example, you had the slide with the FEMA map versus the city's GIS map, and how we had talked about you're looking at from a jet plane 50,000 feet in the air versus us on the ground day in and day out dealing with property owners and understanding the conditions that exist in our community. I do want to commend the city and our IT department. The GIS property viewer on our website is one of the best tools that we have, and one that we are completely grateful for the homeowners to be able to see this data in real time. So you alluded or you referenced the latest round of data, so the post-it notes, the quilts, which is very difficult to interpret, and I've visited DPW. is getting loaded into GIS. So when would you suggest, or when do we expect that to be complete? By the end of this week?
We are shooting for the end of this week, so I would recommend people log on early next week. And if you see a map theme that says 2015 corrected FEMA flood zones, you will know. 2017 corrected FEMA flood zones. Thank you. You will know that it has been uploaded.
So when you said corrected FEMA flood zones, it kind of, I feel, is a little misleading because they're not corrected. They're not official at this point. So should we maybe let the have pending in that title? If we could maybe amend the title of that to just say pending so that when it's effective, because what I find is the last data that we loaded was the August 2015 version. There's been changes in between. Unless you're finding the proper post-it note off the quilt, then you're not understanding your own specific change. And so this is supposed to capture the last 3+ years of updates that we've been working on. And I just, it's still not gospel until we hear back from FEMA that these are accepted, right?
Correct.
And so I don't want, or I guess what the, at least the confusion is, we're telling the homeowner, go to the GIS, here's our resource. And in addition to the GIS system, the city drilled down and we have our topography markings on every two feet versus most municipalities have each at the 10 feet standard. So we've drilled down to provide additional data to the homeowners to the 2-foot topography marks. But this isn't for them to say, here's my accepted FEMA map at that point, correct?
Yes, however, because there's been 5 different puzzle pieces or 5 different quilts, 2 of them are in effect. 2 more will be in March, so that is the component where there is confusion.
Each assuming your bank believes you.
Correct. So we can't get involved in the lender relationships. But checking with DPW to find out which of the quilt pieces you are on will help you if you need to renew before March 31st or April 14th.
So if you're optimistic that your policy, that your property's been affected because of what you'll be able to see in GIS, what if your policy's renewing in February? What's your advice for that homeowner? They're seeing they're out, that the bank's calling them in, they've got to pay up front on their year's policy, and we're optimistic that they'll be out in this
round.
You
are renewing in February before the effective date of some of these. Go to DPW, get a copy of the online viewer and a copy of the correctly effective map.
I've screenshot and sent my constituents this version, your updated version, I mean, to provide this information. You had mentioned, and I know it's been very helpful for a lot of people, the elevation certificates. And I think, hey, we got the big manila envelope in the mail from Woodard and Curran. Keep that aside. This saga keeps continuing. You mentioned elevation certificates being on file at DPW.
Yes.
So for those homeowners who put that manila envelope in a really safe place and now can't find it, we send them to DPW and they have a copy of all of the elevation certificates that the city did. Those are on file at 55 C Street. Normal business hours, people can stop by and get that.
That is correct. And
that's
even if you purchased your home in the last 2 years, the previous homeowner may have had an elevation certificate on file. As long as you haven't raised or lowered the home, the data is still
The data still exists. One of the things that you and I had talked about as we're going through this process is LOMAs. And so what did we say? There was 3,000 properties improved. So there's 3,000 dots on that map, on the citywide map, because there's been a change, not necessarily a full LOMA, but there's been a change, whether a reduction in risk or an amendment. One thing that you and I have talked about with the administration is about doing a LOMA workshop. So let's hold the constituents' hands to the next level. Even though we're working to correct this map on broad scale, neighborhood by neighborhood, we want to protect that individual property. So I think what we had talked about was scheduling, having the elevation certificates accessible electronically, bringing in, we have spoken with the Register of Deeds office so that they can get a copy of their deed. Inspectional Services or Engineering would be providing a copy of the city's plot plan, the elevation certificate, and we'll do a workshop to help people submit that. We're just going to flood the FEMA office with individual LOMA applications for all of these properties to, as you know, probably a secondary corrective measure, right? Is that what you'd describe it?
Yes. Yes, and we'd be happy to be a part of that again. We felt that was an effective tool during the first round of public outreach components. We've also, the two of the primary surveyors who worked on our project have indicated they'd be available for that workshop as well.
So I think that's maybe something we'll look to get. I want the final version of this data available for people, that we're looking at the last version of this map, because part of what we talked to people about was, well, more changes are coming. So what you think might be happening to your property, you know, FEMA's, it's been very difficult because they're giving us one set of information, things aren't aligning, changes are happening, no method, you know, their process changed every step of the way from what we were told, their entire project team. I hope it's not me that scared them out of there, but even the congressional liaison, I mean, every single member of this project team has changed. So it's really hard for us to be able to get this project complete. So let's get a date together for the LOMA workshop to bring the homeowners in for the individual letter of map amendments. Because I think what's most important is we've done so much as a municipality in getting these corrected. Joe, you told me a statistic earlier about Quincy being number one in the Commonwealth for flood insurance policies.
Correct. As of Halloween of this year, FEMA produced some updates, and the city of Quincy has the most flood insurance policies in effect in Massachusetts for a municipality. It's over $400 billion of protected assets and $4 million of annual premiums across about a little over 4,000 policies. So the average policy in Quincy is just under $1,000.
The average policy, you're saying the average Quincy policy is under 1,000.
Correct.
And those, you know, but we have a lot in the $5,000 range.
Correct.
And a lot in the $2,500, $3,000 range. I mean, I would say, you know, the closest, you know, obviously the closest to the water, the higher the risk. But, you know, in the velocity zones are probably almost $10,000 policies, right? So interesting. I don't know too many that have $1,000 policies. They're probably not the ones that call me. But the $2,500, the $5,000, they're saying, geez, my homeowner's policy is only $1,000, and I'm paying $2,500, $5,000 for flood. So that's a, you know, it's a real significant financial impact for the area that I represent. I read recently in the Patriot Ledger about the delegation of South Shore communities heading down to Washington. What do you recommend for our municipality, knowing how strongly impacted we are? I mean, Congressman Lynch's office has been terrific and very responsive and, you know, frequently in communication on this issue every step of the way with us. But what do you recommend that we do to bring our advocacy to the federal level? Because looking at 2018, 2019, to go through this process again, I mean, I'm at a loss of words. I don't know what would be the... what I'd want to say, I mean, it is preposterous. How do you reset this clock again after all the city has been through and all our constituents have been through? So what is your advice on our next level of advocacy? Do we join the South Shore delegation? I know you and I have been down there. Leslie, our consultant with Woods Hole Group, his partner is also working with them. But what do you recommend for our advocacy in getting to the delegation at the federal level to understand Quincy's needs and raise this issue further?
I recommend you consider putting your weight behind lobbying for single corrected holistic maps, and some of the South Shore communities have already begun that effort. You have the most policies for any municipality in the state. You have the most money underinsured in the state, more than Boston, which is very surprising, but according to FEMA statistics is true. You're a heavyweight in this battle. I'd use that weight. And then also set the tone for, we're not going through this again. You've got to get it right going in the first time. You can't just issue maps and expect people to either appeal or just accept it. It's got to be correct.
And I think that's the most important message for them to get. And they feel that each step of the way, all of this homework and all of the effort that we're putting into, you know, the science, a lot of these South Shore communities have learned from what has happened here in Quincy. And we have been the first in the, you know, the first one Norfolk County led, Plymouth County, as far as timing for this map review process. So, you know, we were a bit of the guinea pig of learning this update. And collectively, the South Shore is hearing that the maps are incorrect. Here's the science that's proving what the amendments we need to make. I think we've done a lot to plead our case. But in the meantime, it's not connecting for that resident who's paying this exorbitant, in some cases, flood insurance bills, and especially some of the low-risk, properties. You and I were talking about kind of the neighborhood of Quincy High School and some of the floodplains and the cost of the flood policies in that area that isn't doesn't have the coastal impact. We've done the improvements to the tide gates in the area. I mean, we're doing a lot of infrastructure work as well. I think one thing to note, and I was talking with the administration earlier about the, and you referenced it, it's something else we're working on because of this part of this process, is we have the number, we're in the top tier of discounts with the National Flood Insurance Program. FEMA just completed an audit on permits issued in the floodplain and going out, and they reviewed the city's due diligence in the building projects that we have within our floodplain and where we are in that process. So I think that's another thing that you and I should probably follow up on after the first of the year, see where that stands. I think all of these pieces play together, but what's most important is getting these maps correct. And hopefully we're not doing this again. Two more years. I don't think I can take it. Okay. Other questions I had for you. So I guess on our South Shore, I'll be flying down to Washington with Rep. Cantwell and the Plymouth. I'll try and piggyback on their trip with the federal delegation. I think that's really important that they're hearing and that they're understanding what's happening on the local level. I feel that message is being missed when they're up in the 50,000 feet on their website. I've tried to navigate their map version as well. As for these new maps, as they're pending, you're talking about there's been five effective date changes. And there's been a lot of confusing about whether it's effective, whether it's being accepted, whether the bank's accepting it, whether the insurance companies are agreeing to it. At this point, we're saying the public comment period closes April 14th. Is that after then, FEMA will then issue us kind of the final version and we vote the maps to adopt them then? Or does it just become effective? What procedurally is expected at this point?
That's a good question for this council. If FEMA stays the course and they just issue another corrected puzzle piece, another piece of the quilt, there is no required council action. The quilt becomes effective automatically. If FEMA issues holistic new maps that incorporate all of the changes, those would come before the council to be adopted under the normal 5 or 6 year procedure that has occurred since 1973. So right now, the path that FEMA is on is to not issue new holistic complete maps for the city, just to issue quilt pieces.
Let's keep them all confused.
So right now, there is no pending council action.
Now, those being affected by this recent round of changes, I know that, for example, houses that are technically in the floodplain, some of the properties down in Howes Neck, people own to the mean low water. If you're up on the top of Great Hill, you're way above sea level, but your property tapers off and you might own mean low water. They were getting letters in the last round that your property's been infected by the flood map. Well, technically that's underwater, but your home is clearly far out of the floodplain. What communication are we sending? Is we the city sending anything? Is FEMA doing any communication? What is going to alert the homeowners that their property is specifically affected in this next round of edits?
FEMA is not sending any information. Any information would come from the city.
Have they to date, have they sent anything direct to anybody?
FEMA has not sent anything direct other than letter of map amendment approvals. Mm-hmm. Which is a process that the city is on the outside of. One of the reasons we're striving to convert that list of parcels into addresses is so that the city has the option to notify those who have been removed from the floodplain, which would be about 553 people. Those parcels that have had an improvement to their flood status so that they can then turn and notify their insurers or their mortgage companies. So we are driving to create that address list so that communications can go out from the city to those parcels that have benefited from this long, arduous process.
So we are still compiling our data. So we, the format of how we receive this from FEMA to be able to translate it to make it understandable for you or I who spend a lot of time on this issue versus the individual homeowner who's worried about their specific address. When would you say we're ready or we, the city, will be sending out communication relative to this round of changes. Do we have a public notification requirement from FEMA on this latest information?
We do not, but I would recommend that it be done by the third or fourth week in January. So if anybody would like to comment by April 14th, there's a window of time to understand it, react, and comment.
So I guess I'm just trying to put a timeline of when would be best for us to do our LOMA workshop. So whether we'd want to time that together. I mean, it's two different things, right?
I would say early February.
Early February.
After this letter goes out to notify people.
Okay. And April 14th, 17th, public comment closes. And I'm not going to hold you to this date because not one date we've talked about has stayed. But when assuming the 90-day, 60-day give back, would we anticipate closing the window on this?
FEMA anticipates April 14th, 2017, because they issue the maps with a presumptive approval date.
So let's not read the
comments. Assuming nobody will submit public comments. And because we've now been through this process four previous times, I'm fairly sure they're going to hold strong. You think you want to close the book on this one, Counselor? They really are ready to close the book on this
one. I'd like to see the FEMA flood map issue get over the finish line.
Yeah.
So I assure you I will be writing a letter, as I have every step of the way, for the public comment period. I assure you many of my constituents who are also been frequent flyers on this topic will be issuing comments. You had asked that letters on this topic. Sorry, Mr. Walker. All these letters get addressed to the mayor's office specifically. So, dear Mayor Koch, previously FEMA had rules about our case number being referenced in the letter and kind of some specifics. Is there something similar that needs to be done at this process, or an email to the mayor's office, a letter to the mayor's office? Any communication, open a Facebook comment feed of, here's your opportunity, I'll be passing all these comments on. Is there any formality that needs to be completed for these comments?
There is not, which is one of the benefits of, I believe, this round being compiled, is that DPW can put a cover letter on it with all of the bureaucratic nomenclature required by FEMA and then transmit the bundle.
They thought 44 comments was a lot. I'll probably have 100 and 200 comments on Facebook before the night's over. I just want to thank you. Woodard and Curran, your firm, have been such a great resource for us. Professional staff that you've provided to us, that the Woods Hole Group has brought on board for us in helping raise awareness in this issue. And what's most important for me is getting these maps right. There's no question that the city of Quincy is at risk during storm events. But those who are at a reduced risk or not at risk and are part of a map due to antiquated technology, it's time to get these maps corrected. I think we have put in a lot of effort in doing so. I know for myself and my constituents I represent, I will continue to do so. I will put something together, communication to let people know, some follow-up information. As you know, Ward 1 clearly has the highest volume of these policies, but it's been quite frustrating in being involved in FEMA's process without them understanding what's happening here in our municipality. They don't come out to these neighborhood meetings. They don't come out and talk to the constituents. And it's frustrating in working with this federal agency on something that's so important at the local level. So thank you. Great. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Madam President. Thank you, Mr. Joe Shea, for all your hard work on this. And I had some phone calls that people wanted to get some updates on this. Thank you for coming in tonight. Thank you, Quincy DPW, for all your help and assistance on this matter. It's been, I guess I could say this on air, it's kind of a scam to produce more financial money for the big catastrophic situations that have happened across the U.S. And unfortunately, we got hit pretty hard with this. I have a couple of questions just about now, on these 4,600 impacted parcels, over the course of the time when this happened, is it to my understanding, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, that all these insurance situations are based on upon the fact that you have some type of lender or financing that you're doing with your house. Now, if you have your house paid for, do you still have to get the insurance for this?
You do not.
So
FEMA does not require flood insurance. The general laws do not require flood insurance. It is the mortgage companies that require flood insurance. So if you bought your house with cash or if you own it outright, it is your personal choice as to whether you want flood insurance.
That leads me into the second question. Of these 4,600 impacted parcels, let's start off with the 2,700, then the 1,400, then the 500. Mm-hmm. Of those, since this new information came out that you have to have increased amount of insurance into your package, I guess you could call it, of these, do you have any numbers based on the fact that paying down these mortgages, paying down these lending, whatever the note on it was, do you have any numbers that people
we
say, hey,
not.
Listen, I don't want to pay insurance. FEMA's trying to get me on this end. I owe $90,000 on my house. I'm going to refinance it. I'm going to pull some money out of this end and pay it down and get rid of this insurance. Do you have any numbers on that?
We do not on individual houses. We know there are about 4,100 flood insurance policies in effect in Quincy as of October 31st, 2016. And we know there are more than 4,600 houses in the floodplain. So we can in aggregate say there's several hundred that fall into that category, but we do not know individual homes, who moves into the process and who moves out of the process.
So unless a new person comes in and buys a house, unless they're putting all cash down and not having a mortgage or going through a lender, that they cannot have to pay flood insurance.
Correct.
Correct. Now, I would say that, and you correct me if I'm wrong, that each lender is not going to allow you to buy the house unless you, if you have flood, if this has to do flood insurance, you have to carry it. Is that correct?
That was my personal experience and what I've heard now hundreds of times from people purchasing homes in the flood.
Last question. Of these parcels that have been impacted, how much turnover of houses have you seen go to sale and people have bought? Do you see people saying, you know, I wasn't in the floodplain before. I got pushed into the floodplain. I really can't afford this extra $1,500, $3,000, whatever it is. I'm just going to sell my property and move on.
I have not.
To an area that's not in the floodplain.
I don't have any data on that, Counselor. I've heard anecdotally, we have received dozens of calls from people who are at a closing, panicking on the phone, saying, I'm at a closing. Flood insurance has now come up. Can you please send us some information? To which we could use the property viewer and at least get some information to them about whether they are truly in or out. But I don't have any statistics about people moving out of the flood zone.
It would be really good if I could, maybe if you could offline, if you could maybe get some more information on that. It's just to look back on the data and the skew of the different turnover that's happened in the city of Quincy over the last 2 years since this happened. I mean, we've seen an increase in sales. I've seen also with more produced housing as well, but we also see a lot of turnover, and I want to see if this impacts it at all. Just something to learn about the city and as we move forward, what the impact of FEMA did for Quincy in 2014, 15, 16, we're going into 17 now. I have to agree with Councilor LaForest on it. Especially her ward, as well as Councilor Kane, Councilor Harris, and Councilor Hughes, it's put a strain on some of those houses that are in these wards throughout this time. And here we are. It's almost like the brakes were put on and they're still not producing much information to the public. So if I get some of that information, it really helped me. I think it helped the other counselors as well as the city to find out data on how to move forward with something like this, because I'm sure there's going to be more catastrophic things happening in the United States of America. With that, thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Very quickly, Joe, I just thank you very much for your presentation tonight. As always, Wood and Curran just answers every question that we continue to get, and you in particular have been a tremendous help to not only the city and but to the residents, and so I thank you for that. Just two very quick questions regarding the new tact for FEMA regarding inland streams and waterways. Just first question is, so folks who need to be sort of mindful of this next, people who don't live on the coast, like a lot of Council of Forest folks, but people like myself who live near the brook in Quincy, who maybe never thought about it because they don't live on the coast, need to sort of be mindful of the fact that this is starting to, is going to start to affect them.
Correct.
And then when you hear in the past, you also spoke about the fact that you felt like FEMA wanted to take on some of your thoughts, some help, not just you particularly, but some of the cities and towns who've been giving them grief over the last revision of the coastal maps, wanted to sort of work with you cooperatively to correct some of the mistakes that might have happened in the last revisions regarding the coastal maps. Do you still feel that that's FEMA's attitude, or is there a shift? Are they just doing this on their own in a vacuum, or do you feel like they are sort of taking the input of communities who've pushed back on the coastal maps?
I believe they are taking the input of communities. We've had two meetings. Chen has joined us at both with the USGS and FEMA regarding specifically regarding Furnace Brook and Town Brook infrastructure, which was a process that didn't exist in 2013, 2014.
Good.
So there clearly has been a change in the process. We're going to model that through to make sure there's a change in the outcome.
Yeah, well, hopefully it carries through the outcome. Well, thank you very much, Joe, and I appreciate it. And we'll be hearing more from in the future. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Councilors.